Hey, we're live.
There we are. That looks live to me. Tweeting out. Hi, Madara Zitzkeka, Dabba Dooba Derp, and Knob Yogurt. How I've missed you all.
Dabba Dooba Derp? That's like the I'm Blue song.
Aha.
I'm Blue Dabby Debop Dop.
All right. How you doing, everyone? Thanks for subscribing to Purple Marauder for 10 months. It's the post-EP stream. And today's Zero Punctuation was a little digest of the most significant games from the 2010s.
Mm-hmm.
I'm joined by Jack Packard, obviously. There he is.
Hello. I'm here as well.
And I think one of my conclusion from that video was that Dark Souls was basically one of my most significant influential games of the decade. So here it is, the remastered version. Oh, Jack, you're already in this game.
Oh, I get it.
I made a little funny about the thing because he's bald.
Because I'm bald. Yeah, no, I get it. No, that was a good joke and congratulations on making it.
Well, mostly bald. You're looking a little fuzzy this morning.
First of all, this is what I look like after a week of not shaving, and I hate it. I need to shave very, very quickly. You might be able to see some very small gray hairs, but I desperately, desperately need to shave.
Yeah, my grays are coming in the beard first.
Do you have a goal for this playthrough? Are you going to go wizard? You're going to go strong guy? Are you going to try to accomplish something in the 2 hours? Or is this just good old-fashioned fucking around?
Well, the fucking around was very much at the forefront of my mind. But I thought I might take requests from the audience.
Ooh.
So what class? What class do you want? You know, I've played like fuckloads of this game. Treat me rough. No hit speed run. Yeah, piss off, Iperazzi. Oh, everyone wants deprived. Of course you do.
If you say hurt me in Dark Souls, that's what you need. You know, I've never seen anyone go... I personally have never played Pyromancer or Cleric.
Pyromancer basically just turns into another melee class fairly swiftly. Mm-hmm. I take Pyromancy whatever class I am. I mean, you might as well.
Sure.
All right. And what special item am I taking with me, chat? Out of the list here. Goddess's Blessing, Black Firebomb, Twin Humanities, Binoculars, Pendant, Master Key, Tiny Being's Ring, Old Witch's Ring. Most of these wouldn't really make a significant change to the game. Mm-hmm. Oh, you want me to take Pendant, do you? The one that the developer admits does nothing. Okay. Lots of votes for Master Key now, because Master Key is the one that can significantly change the course of the game.
Yeah, that's... You know, my very first playthrough of Dark Souls, I went in as blind as I possibly could, and I chose the Master Key, and I went to areas I now know that I should not have gone to so early on.
Yeah, that was your mistake.
But I figure, oh, Master Key, this is a very helpful item. I'll definitely take that. But then you end up in... Blight Town.
And... Yeah, you don't want to go end up there early on.
Mm-mm.
Let's go gray hairs. Put me in the mood for it. All right, let's go. Let's go.
Let's do some Dark Souls.
Is it worth getting Dark Souls remastered for PC, the Verbal Marauder? Well, you know, it's better than having to play it through Games for Windows Live.
Mm-hmm. No. Right, because you can no longer buy the unremastered version on Steam, correct?
No idea. I still have the unremastered version, but I had it beforehand. But then there was fire. But it wouldn't surprise me. The remastered version doesn't actually change anything, really.
Right.
It looks a bit better, and it's a little better optimized for modern PCs, but it's exactly the same.
Oh, sure. And unless your question was about getting it for PC versus getting it on a console, and I played all of my Dark Souls playing on my Switch, and it was great.
Good on the Switch, is it?
Here's my one complaint on the Switch is they didn't switchify the confirm and back button.
Thanks to £10, Red Panda, who says, two of my favorites playing one of my fave games. Here's some spending paper. Thank you, Red Panda.
Thanks, Red Panda.
I'm glad you brought up the Switch, because that was another thing I mentioned in my review of the Decade video today.
Mm-hmm.
Because I've really come around to the Switch. It's the only console I keep in my living room rather than my office that I dick around with in the off hours. Because you can just set it up straight away.
Mm-hmm.
I've actually got a decent controller for it now, since I bought the Pro Controller. And it's got a good list of indie titles to download that are actually curated, unlike some digital stores I could name.
Well, partially curated. Yeah. I mean, Nintendo, the eShop has a lot of garbage.
Well, yes, but it can't compare to the Steam level of garbage.
I'm going to put this out here. What can?
Yeah, it's a little bit mystifying, that.
Mm-hmm. But no, I love my Switch. I've always been a big fan of portable games. I was a diehard Vita fan for the longest time.
Mm.
And you know, I was with it up until the death throes. I was all for the Vita.
See, I name dropped the Switch as a capsule of the decade because it sort of represents all the progress Nintendo's made over the course of the decade.
Mm-hmm.
It encapsulates that little dalliance with motion controls that didn't really go anywhere. But it's in the Switch you can see little bits of all the failed Nintendo consoles from the last 10 years. It's the like the Joy-Cons remind me of the Wii modes. Mm-hmm. You got the Wii U portable and also home console factor. You got the 3DS handheld factor. They learned. Nintendo learned.
Yes, and they keep pushing forward. They keep pushing forward, and now we're seeing... I don't know if you've been paying attention to CES at all.
Thanks for subscribing, copy number 8. No, I'm afraid I haven't.
They just announced a prototype. It's not... hold on, let me find out who made it before I start blathering. But a PC... that is basically a souped-up Switch that Dell is making. Actually, Dell with Dell. So you know, it's all prototypes, and obviously, it won't be very very powerful. But it's basically a small powerful tablet with two controllers on the side that theoretically will just be able to run Windows, and it's pretty exciting looking.
BlackDraco28 on YouTube says, everyone invade Yahtzee. Please don't. PvP is in this game are nuts.
Wait, are you playing online?
Well, yeah.
Oh, I don't play online.
I might go offline later once we're out of the prologue, but... Because, yeah, when you're on stream, you tend to get invaded a lot. Now, people who think it's important that everyone see how good they are at cheating. This is
your fate. how good can you roll? That's what we're going to find out.
Every time someone invades me in this game, I think, okay, I'm going to try to be competitive here. Mm-hmm. And then they just materialize behind me and backstab me, and I have no idea how.
Always. Did I watch the RLM Mandalorian review? I have not, but I know I usually don't watch their reviews because I'll just see them and talk to them about it in real life. And so I tend not to watch their reviews unless it's like an older thing that that I'm interested in.
Have you seen The Mandalorian? I have not.
No, I have.
I did not.
Oh, you haven't seen any of it?
No, I have no Disney Plus and not much inclination to get it.
Sure. Yes, I have watched and seen the entirety of the first season of The Mandalorian, and I don't know if this is in line with them, but it's a perfectly adequate show.
Well, that seems to have been their conclusion as well, yes.
There you go.
It's certainly a better use of Star Wars than the new trilogy, they were saying.
I think if we can compare The Mandalorian to The Rise of Skywalker, The Mandalorian wins the race. Absolutely.
Someone in Centric Shizno says not getting a sub acknowledgement. Sorry, did I miss someone? I'm hypnotized by the amazingness of Dark Souls. And I admit that might not be coming across at this stage.
Oh, I do. I see that now. Sorry. You know what? There was too many comments and it scrolled up too fast. But Centric Shinsno, thank you for subscribing for 3 months now. It just scrolled up a little too fast. Very, very sorry that we did not acknowledge you. This is my job. I should be doing better. But I also am watching Yahtzee play Dark Souls.
Oh, this takes me back. When I was doing Uncivil War with Jim Sterling, one of the little games we did was trying to break as many of these pots without dying. And without setting off the next part of the game. Man, that's a lot more health than I usually lose at that bit. Is it me, or has the loincloth gotten skimpier? I don't remember it being this skimpy in the original version.
You know, I think they know what their fans want.
That's leaving very little to the imagination. So, would I be right in assuming that you would also nominate this for one of your games of the decade, Jack?
I did, in the last part of my game of the decade review, I did not specifically call out Dark Souls. I specifically called out Bloodborne because I played Bloodborne first.
Okay.
And so, to me, Bloodborne is more important than Dark Souls, because it got... I mean, and of course, I love Dark Souls. I've played it several times.
Thanks for subscribing. No adjectives.
For 6 months now. Thank you. But I assume you played Dark Souls first.
Oh, yeah. I got like 300 hours clocked between this and previous versions. And, I haven't played as much Bloodborne purely, mainly because it's PS4 exclusive and can't be bothered to start it when I've already got the computer going.
That's really true.
Which is a shame. I wish they would do a PC release. I wish they'd do a PC release of Demon's Souls. I can go back and try that again.
You know what? We need a box set.
Ah, yeah. That was one of my Christmas presents. I got a box set of all the Columbo episodes.
First of all, amazing Christmas present.
I know. My wife and I, we are big Columbo fans.
Everyone should be a big Columbo fan. Peter Falk is amazing.
Yeah, he found the role that was going to pay all his checks for the rest of his life, and he stuck with it.
The thing I always loved about Columbo is how easily it could have gone wrong. You know, like it's a detective mystery show, but you know who the murderer is.
Yeah, that's the gimmick. It's a how catch 'em, not a who done it.
Yes, and it's something that could have failed so easily, but just because of the procedure, because of the attention to detail, they really walk you through all of his steps as a detective. Perfect show.
Yeah.
Perfect show.
But anyway, so my other game of the decade, I would say, was Undertale. I wouldn't consider it one of the hugely influential or significant in that sense, because hasn't really had as many imitators. It hasn't really... I mean, Dark Souls has created an entire adjective. Things can be
like.
Things are Souls-like, and every time something's difficult, it's the Dark Souls of whatever it was. But Undertale was just a perfectly made emotional experience, using the smallest amount of ingredients.
Well, and you know, it was more a product of the popularity of indie games, not the thing that started the popularity of indie games. Much like you mentioned, The Binding of Isaac.
Yeah.
That really helped cement indie games as a legitimate category.
Particularly indie games made by very small teams, if not one person. And that's why it's important to me, because I still believe in auteurism in game design. Alright, Asylum Demon, this time I'm ready for ya. I got my horrible bad shield.
And your club, you're good to go.
And no black firebombs. Which would be another way to get through this quickly. You know, one thing I was never... I've always, like, tried to get better at is the parrying in Dark Souls.
Oh, you're not a parrier.
It's that's why Sekiro didn't click as much as it could have with me, because that's all parry all the time, that game.
And, you know, I'll say I am a big parrier in Souls, in the Soulsborne games, and I also hated Sekiro. mostly
then.
Because I feel like their window for parrying was comically too short. No, there was no flexibility in their parry. You must do it this way and only this way, and nothing but perfection is what we will accept.
Yeah, what I always liked about Dark Souls, it has had very varied approaches to combat.
Absolutely. Play the game how you wish.
I mean, in Sekiro, you literally have one sword, and that you cannot change.
Oh, yeah. I am with you. And, you know, going back a little bit before we get too off topic, speaking of Undertale, I rather enjoyed Undertale, but I don't think I would have liked it at all if I had not streamed it.
Okay.
Rich and I played Undertale on stream for the entirety of Undertale, and we had a fantastic time playing it together.
I think I remember, yes.
And, you know, we did the voices, we came up with little bits, we would take turns with the controller, and it was a fantastic experience, but I think if I played it by myself, I would have gotten bored.
Really?
I think so. I and, you know, there's no knowing for sure.
Undertale worked for me because it's well written, it made me laugh, but at the end of the day, it really sort of got to me emotionally at times as well. I mean, there are moments in the good ending, there are very specific moments where I just well up every time. And no, that's hard to picture with my cold, repressed British attitude, but something about it just really gets me. It's about, you know, rediscovering the humanity in someone who's like became a monster out of self-defense. It's something to do with that.
hit a little too close to home for you? Is that what you're saying?
It's possible. All right, well, time to get some bloody stats. Yeah, all resistance build, no thanks. Well, we got a club. I guess we'll put some in strength.
Do it. Hey, Pup Shepherd, thank you for the $5. Pup Shepherd says, wag, wag, arf, arf. Long-time listener, first-time caller. As I age, I now like making content about games as opposed to playing them. How about you?
Oh, no, I still like playing them. Although I will say, one thing that I noted that might be a sign of age recently is that I prefer giving Christmas presents to people than receiving them now. I prefer giving someone something thoughtful and seeing their reaction when they open it. Maybe that means I'm ready for fatherhood.
I think so. I think you've done it. You've passed the test, and now you are able to have a child. Congratulations.
Well, that's lucky.
Skyrim influential? When did Skyrim come out? Was that this decade?
Yeah, what year was that? It must have been early on in the decade, if it was this decade.
You know, Skyrim is influential in just the amount of things it's been released on, I suppose.
Yeah.
It's a fantastic game. Hey, Max Melbourne, thanks for subscribing 2 months in a row. We appreciate that. 2011. Well, shit then. Yeah. Well, open world play. I mean, if we're talking about Dark Souls and play as you like, no, you know, no one does it more robustly than Skyrim.
Hmm. I mean, Dark Souls isn't really an open world game in the sense of your Skyrim.
Oh no, I was just talking about in the flexibility of play styles.
Right.
You know, the dumping stats, the min-maxing is elevated in Skyrim.
Yeah. Min-maxing your way to the perfect stealthy archer every time.
Mm-hmm. Oh man, it's so easy to be a stealthy archer.
All right, let's practice our parries a bit. Come on, you. Okay, I wasn't ready. I wasn't ready again. Come on. Oh, I did it too early that time. Man, it's been a while.
You can get there.
Oh.
Uh-oh. Nope, too many people now. So, Nick Kazee says, some people consider Cave Story the father of indie games.
Yeah.
What do you think?
Yeah, I'd put that up there. That was one of the very early solo-developed retro-style indie hits. That must have been 2004, I think. Mm-hmm. Like, that's like practically retro now, as well as retro styled. Mm-hmm.
And would you? I guess my counter argument would be that might be the grandfather, because it wasn't as popular as, say, your what was the rewind time platformer?
Oh, Braid.
Braid.
Braid,
you.
By Jonathan Blow.
Yes. That was a legitimately big hit. Something like your Braid or your Super Meat Boy might consider more the father of, and Cave Story the grandfather.
Yeah, because of course Meat Boy was by the Binding of Isaac, dude, but came before. Oh, come on.
Yeah. By Edmund. And
yeah,
who was the programmer for that?
I was looking this up because I wasn't sure if it was fair to say Binding of Isaac was like a solo developed game. But yeah, there was like a second guy, but no one remembers. So sorry, second guy.
They're two different guys. There's the Meat Boy programmer and the Isaac programmer. Tommy Refines, thank you. He was the Meat Boy programmer. And now, who knows the original Isaac programmer? Yes, Edmund and Florian Kimsel.
That was it. I was looking this up.
Thank you.
Binding of Isaac was, of course, very influential because it sparked the beginning of the roguelite craze.
Absolutely. I called out both Binding of Isaac and Spelunky.
Yeah, that would be the other one.
For the roguelike mashup mania that we see today. And hey, thanks Red Panda for the £5. Red Panda says, hey, do you guys have a favorite weapon in the Soulsborne game? Also, remove skeleton.
I don't know. I guess I lean towards faster and more efficient weapons.
Mm. I will default to big, slow, and strong.
Yeah, I prefer something that gives me the chance to duck the moment I mess up.
Sure.
And roll away. I'm not usually a club guy, but I'm using what I've been given. Oh! Well, I've just been given a short sword. Let's use that instead.
Hey, that's perfect timing. Perfect coincidental timing.
Fwa! Fwa! Bastard Zero says, for me, Rogue Legacy opened my eyes to roguelikes. Yeah, that was an early one. Not as early as the others, but I remember playing a lot of that one.
Rogue Legacy?
Yeah. It was more sort of Castlevania-y roguelike.
That was an interesting roguelike in that it also lets you build up stats between runs.
Yes.
Which is why I never cared for it, like other roguelikes. Like your... like FTL. That was the other. That's another good one.
Well, some roguelikes, they take the Binding of Isaac model where your progress is measured by how many new things are added to the random rolls, whereas and some measure your progress with an actual sense of progress, like your Rogue Legacy. But there does, I feel there does have to be some sense of progress.
Sure. What was I thinking of here? I think the big difference, I think, between as far as what I enjoy out of a roguelike is whether or not there is enough synergy, which Isaac, of course, is the ultimate example of synergy, because all items mesh together to create new super tiers.
That's what I like about Isaac. It's got a deceptively simple core gameplay loop. So you can have a build that at the late game stage is vastly different to whatever your build was in the late game stage the last time you played.
Absolutely. It's what I'm really enjoying now about Slay the Spire, which is the game I'm playing in my off, in my not work play time. Which deck building roguelike, fantastic.
I've been replaying Mario Odyssey for my spare timey game lately. No particular reason. It's just nice. When I streamed some A Hat in Time over the weekend, and I remembered Mario is a very efficiently, very well-designed platformer, but it always feels kind of emotionally dead. And A Hat in Time plays a lot like it, but not quite as polished, but it is a much more enjoyable experience as a story and appreciation of characters.
Sure, and I suppose the reason I laugh so much at that is you are the first person I have ever heard talk about Mario in any emotional sense.
Well, quite. I mean, nobody does. I mean, right. It's just sort of a blank slate in everyone's minds. We all understand how it works. Mario saves the princess, Bowser is a slightly inept bad guy, and everyone else is just blandly nice all the time.
Right. I guess to me that was the comedy of it, is just implying that there could be any emotion in a Mario game.
Well, there could. I mean, look at the Paper Marios.
Oh, those are
that had the took the opportunity to be a bit irreverent with the franchise, and that's why they worked so well for me.
I even liked the what were the DS ones, the Mario and Luigi Superstar Sagas.
Yeah.
Those were fun.
All the Mario RPGs were had a little bit more fun with it.
Agreed.
Well, the good news is I found some trousers.
Ooh, I mean, is that good news? The people are here for G-strings, all right? They know what's up.
Maybe I could do one of those builds where you immediately have to equip everything you find. One of those runs.
Oh.
Where, yeah, eventually you find a sorcerer's catalyst and completely dick yourself over.
I like this look, though. This is very chic.
It's a bit, it's a bit Crash Diet Kratos, isn't it?
You know, he just started keto, and he's cutting right now. He's working up to the bulk, absolutely.
Lord Terminal says Mario and Luigi hit their prime Bowser's inside story. After that, Alpha Dream was suffering burnout. I'll agree with that. I thought the Mario and Luigi's after Bowser's inside story were a bit by the numbers. I think the difference is that whenever they treat Bowser as a more complex character than just stock villain, it tends to be a bit more interesting. I mean, Mario RPG on the SNES was the first Mario RPG where Bowser was a party member rather than just filling the role of villain again. And in like the later Mario and Luigi's, Bowser's just a villain again, and that feels like a regression.
And we're not counting Mario Kart?
Apparently not. Though we were talking about RPGs. You know, make Bowser out as a character. Slightly more of a tragic figure. I mean, when we were replaying Mario Odyssey, the wife was in the room, and we got to the bit at the end where you're at Bowser's wedding, and he's trying to force his ring on Princess Peach, and the wedding's just full of people who were forced to be there. rather than Bowser's friends.
Right.
And we just looked at each other and said, this is really sad. I feel really bad for Bowser looking at this.
Yeah.
I mean, he's clearly, you know, trying to be socially upwardly mobile here.
Mary's
princess.
Just,
and he just has no idea how to approach it.
I thought it was that entire wedding sequence was very, very strange, just because the amount of guests.
Yeah.
I mean, like, Pauline is there.
Yeah. Pauline and like a couple of token dudes from all the lands, but where's, you know, Bowser's actual friends? Like Bowser's children, for example.
Well, I'm just wondering why they're all there. Like, they all probably know Bowser's deal, yet they're like enabling him kidnapping the princess.
I guess
they're enabling him.
I guess none of them feel equipped to fight him, besides Mario.
I guess.
Well, no one really felt hostile towards him. Most of them just seemed kind of nonplussed. It's like, why have I been brought here? What's all this about?
Mm-hmm. Oh, wait, were they brought there, or did they choose to go?
I think that was the implication. Like, they were forced to be there to fill out the numbers. But then, like, you take a closer look at the room, and like, all the banquet tables been set up, and all the cutlery is perfectly arranged, and you just picture Bowser doing that before everyone arrives. Thinking he needs to like find a hobby or something.
I think you know, if I can just show them that I can put this wedding together, Peach is gonna say yes. She's gonna see all the hard work I did and really finally appreciate me for what I do. we'll get a like a Bowser prequel. How he came to be the villain that we know.
If only Nintendo did DLC.
Oh
boy, black firebombs. Just what I need.
I will tell you, in all of my playthroughs, I think I've beaten Dark Souls maybe 5 times now. In all of my playthroughs, I have never once used the bombs.
Really?
Never.
Well, they're good if you feel like being expedient, because you can get through the Asylum Demon and Taurus Demon fights in a snap. If you use your back firebombs.
Maybe that's it. I think I'm just too stubborn. Where it's like, no, I'm going to whittle them down bit by bit.
See, is that the thinking, or is it, but what if I run into something harder later where I really need it?
Oh, yes, a deadly combination of both.
Well, not that I want to jinx myself, but I haven't been invaded yet.
Uh-oh.
Oh, wait. I can only be invaded if I'm human, can't I? Ha-ha.
Ooh,
just
you've
remembered.
Done it. You've gamed the system.
So what did you think of Dark Souls 2 and 3?
2 was interesting.
Yeah, that's the word for it.
It wasn't the thing I liked. But it wasn't bad. It just wasn't the thing that I liked about Dark Souls.
You know, I played Dark Souls 2 a lot more than I ended up playing Dark Souls 3.
Mm.
Clocked up 300 hours in Dark Souls 2 as well.
Oh.
But I did think it was a lot... It felt a lot more... It felt... Well, Dark Souls is really well designed because all the like areas are interconnected.
Mm-hmm.
Sort of Metroidvania style. And Dark Souls 2, especially from a certain point onwards... It's just going through a linear sequence of worlds that's got one way in and one way out.
Yeah, it definitely, like, you know, like kind of what we were talking about with Sekiro, is there definitely was a more of a constraint in Dark Souls 2 that I did not necessarily appreciate.
Yeah.
And 3, I think, is fantastic, but I feel almost that was by the numbers Dark Souls.
I know what you mean. It felt like... For want of a better word, it felt a bit sequel-y.
Yeah.
In ways that Dark Souls 2 didn't. But like, here's all your favorite things that you remember from Dark Souls 1.
Mm-hmm. Fantastic enemy design in 3, though.
Yeah, I mean, when like Sigmar shows up in Dark Souls 3, I was like, okay, this is fan wank now.
but you know, you get to fight the giant tree with testicles, and that's fun.
Yeah.
But it almost it was Oh, I'm trying to remember now. Dark Souls 3 was like The Force Awakens, whereas like everything was there, everything that should have been there was there. It just didn't feel natural.
Right.
Even though it's very good, like it's all the 3 is very good. It just doesn't feel fresh.
Yeah. I felt it was a bit too much, a lot of like overused, samey environments. It all felt like lots of cathedrals, lots of dungeons. Mm-hmm. And it wasn't all that, but felt like there was a lot of it. I mean, how did you, can a game be have like too much? And I was thinking this after I played Black Mesa, after they released the Zen levels. Is this mm-hmm. too much Zen? Because it's a lot of Zen.
There's something to be said about being surprised.
Hmm.
I recently saw 2 movies, and I'm going to use this as a elongated metaphor for Dark Souls here. I recently, but before I get that, we'll say thank you, Hidden Gem Gamer, for the $5, who says, "Hey guys, I'm a big fan of Raven Software, and I hate how Activision is forcing them to work on Call of Duty. I really love Singularity. Would you like a sequel?"
I'm not sure there's anywhere a sequel could go, mm-hmm. but I do think Singularity was a bit underrated.
And I don't know if I played it.
It was a bit all over the place. It felt like a sort of mashup of Half-Life and Bioshock and a couple of other games.
Mm.
But, and a lot of it sort of blurs together in my memory. I just remember it had a surprisingly good ending.
But you don't necessarily remember what that ending is.
I remember the ending, just everything between the start and the end, sort of. It's just a big grey mass of generic FPS stuff.
Sure.
With some, like, temporal gimmicks.
Mm-hmm.
Thanks for the $5, Brian Dunn, who asks, "Jack, when was the last time you dressed as a clown?"
I did so recently for a Halloween party. Still, I even found my original clown shoes.
Still had the old gear kicking around.
No, I had to get a new outfit, but clown shoes are rather expensive, and so I still have my original clown shoes.
Can't just buy shoes that are 3 sizes too big and use them?
No, because then they'd be hard to walk in.
Oh.
So you have to buy special shoes that fit your feet and then have an extra section.
I see.
Or I suppose you could buy bigger shoes, it would just be harder to walk in, you know, put some padding in them. But, so, in any case, Dark Souls, here are 2 movies I saw recently, both very good, but one I enjoyed exponentially more, which one is Ford versus Ferrari,
and
the other is Ready or Not.
Okay.
And Ford versus Ferrari is, you know, a biopic, top-tier talent, a very, very fine movie, but also just adequate. You know, you kind of know the beats, you know what's going to happen. You're not surprised at anything by Ford versus Ferrari.
Okay, we're going for a Zero Estes Taurus Demon battle.
Zero Estes?
Zero Estes.
Oh, jeez. Good luck.
I'm trying it.
You can do it. I believe in you. Are you going to cheese him?
I think I might do some cheesy things.
Are you going to ladder cheese him?
I'm going to do quite a bit of ladder cheesing, assuming I don't die now. Oh, no. I'm alive.
So in any case, Ford vs. Ferrari is a fine movie. It's a very good movie, but you know exactly what's going to happen, and that will take away some enjoyment from it. Whereas a smaller movie like Ready or Not, you don't know what's going to happen, and that immeasurably enhances your enjoyment. That was the end of my little thing, and that's why 2 is more interesting, maybe not better. And Fisticles, thank you for the $5, who says, "Remaster Star Trek Voyager Elite Forces."
I remember that.
GOG. "It's been long enough, I don't need another Souls game. Milking a franchise I just played every new year."
Well, that'll teach me for being cocky, I suppose. Didn't even, like, sit at the bonfire. Perhaps that was my error.
There you go.
I guess I forgot to. I wasn't cockiness, I just literally forgot.
Oh, you didn't sit at the middle bonfire.
Yeah. Okay. That didn't go well. Let's try that again.
Was Star Trek Voyager Elite Force, was that the Star Trek first-person shooter?
Yes. Well, there were two. The second one wasn't very good. First one was actually all right, for what it was.
Star Trek first-person shooter.
Thanks to $10 Hidden Gem Gamers. He says, fun fact, the original version of Singularity was developed for over 2 years till Activision forced Raven to scrap it, and the version we got was made in less than 10 months. Check the 2009 E3 demo. Okay. Mm-hmm. Thanks for the inside info.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, go away, bloody Hollows. Stop chasing me. That one's it following me. It's doing it follows at me. Okay, it's going away now.
He just wants to say hey. I noticed you went up the stairs. Just wanted to say hey.
Nick says, Singularity always reminds me about a very fun game called Time Shift. Yeah, I remember Time Shift as well. That's another game that felt very Half-Life-y. But with Half-Life 2, but with time manipulation gimmicks instead of physics gimmicks.
Oh, interesting.
So you could like slow down time and run around and give everyone wedgies, that sort of thing.
Oh, that's fun.
You know what I always think a slow motion in games needs? Slow motion can like be fun while you're doing it, but I think it's a lot better if after the slow motion is done, it shows you what you just did at normal speed.
Kind of like you're super hot.
Yeah, or Katana Zero.
Ah.
Alright, fine, I'll kill this guy.
I always liked that part of Super Hot. After you get done with a level, they show you what it looks like in real time.
Yeah, I wish they didn't keep voicing over it with right. the old like title text going super hot, super hot. Could have done without that.
I think it would have been nice to see that in third person or from a different perspective, because in first person it's just too nauseous.
Right. I was playing Super Hot VR the other day.
Oh, how was that?
It was good. I've been getting back into VR lately. I'm going to review a VR game next week, actually.
Oh.
So that'd be one to miss if you get motion sickness. But I only really like VR games if they let me sit down. And Super Hot VR I was enjoying up to the point I couldn't get past the level because they spawned all the guns under me couch.
Spoken like a true gamer.
I think a lot of like VR motion controls like pushes fail to understand is that being able to be comfortable is a big part of getting immersed in a game. And I can't be comfortable standing up. I'm very top heavy and my feet start hurting if I do it too long.
Sure.
I feel a lot more immersed sitting down with a button controller in my hand than I do standing up waving an invisible sword about.
Comfort is an important thing.
Oh, bugger. Rolled straight into him there.
Cudlack13, thank you for the $5, who says, what games from the decade do you think deserves a second chance, i.e. a remake rather than a remaster?
Well, as we say, there's a lot of games that were console exclusive I'd like to be able to, you know, play. We mentioned Bloodborne, Demon's Souls, but I'd like to replay Infamous and Infamous 2. Those are like PS3 exclusive. Can't fucking play them now.
Oh, look those at that were... guy just hanging off the edge.
Yeah, he's doing his thing.
Fall off already.
Oh! That was devious. What a bastard.
Oh, I just see what he did there. Haha, he gotcha. Yeah, and you know, the entire remake, remaster conversation is a tricky one just because the amount... You're talking about a lot of man hours to completely remake something. And so, you know, can you... reasonably ask a game development company to do that for a game that maybe wasn't so popular to begin with.
I thought Infamous 2 was good.
I'm not saying necessarily that about Infamous, it's just a general statement.
I mean, they brought out an Infamous game for PS4, Second Son, it was called. And if you're going to bring out sequels, then I would think it would make sense to make the originals playable still.
I agree. That would be a good marketing strategy.
Yeah, like, once you bring out a sequel, you could do like a bundle pack with all the previous ones for cheaper, for cheapo cost.
You know, play the first part of the story.
Like when American McGee brought out Alice Madness Returns, it just came with a free copy of the original Alice as well.
Oh.
Which I guess was for the best, because you really couldn't get the plot without having played through that.
Thank you again, Hidden Gem Gamers, for the $5, who says, I made a review for the game. Oh, I assume you're talking about Singularity, on my channel, and even managed to interview a dev named Keith Fuller. We talked about the difficulties of a Rush product. So that's why Hidden Gem Gamers know so much about the Singularity development.
And Fisticles donated $5, thank you, who says, Outcast Second Contact, please, unremake.
Unremake?
I didn't even know there was another Outcast game. I know the first Outcast game was that Rare Beast, an open world game made with voxel graphics.
Mmm. Ugh. Was it good? Wait a minute.
It has its charms, and it has its supporters. It probably hasn't aged very well, although it kind of looked like shit when the day it came out.
It has its charms. That's a very polite way of saying it does not look good.
Ooh, new shield. That might help.
Ooh, there you go. And Red Panda, thank you for the £5, who says, do you guys think with the success of Resident Evil 2 remake, and if 3 does well, they will do a 4 remake?
That doesn't make a lot of sense to me. I mean, remaking 3 makes sense because 2 and 3 both look very, very dated now. Mm-hmm. But I think RE4 still holds up as an experience. RE4 was arguably the game that gave birth to the next generation of third-person shooters, over-the-shoulder games.
And you know what? A fantastic game, a fantastic Resident Evil game. I prefer that's my preferred Resident Evil game.
Yeah, it was the first Resident Evil game I actually liked.
Yes.
The rest, the ones that before that, I just couldn't get past the very awkward movement and very laughable writing.
I feel like in 4 they finally kind of let you in that they were in on the joke. Like, yes, this is cheesy, but we're going for cheesy.
Exactly. It's full of B-movie self-awareness.
Yes.
I mean, if you don't get that from the first time you see Midget Napoleon, and I don't know what to tell you.
Or the fight with El Gigante. Yeah, that's great.
A little bit of insider information, but one of the rejected topics that didn't fit into this week's video was Resident Evil 7, which was another thing I considered one of the better games of the decade, and possibly a representative of trends of the decade.
Oh, why is that?
Well, firstly, it does the same thing Resident Evil 4 did. It sort of reawakened the franchise by taking a new approach and being a little bit self-aware and campy with it. And also it represents the sort of outcast trend of horror games moving towards these first-person experiences.
Ooh, okay.
Rather than the traditional alone in the dark fixed camera third person thing.
Sure. I don't remember fully. I think someone in the chat will remember. I think I played a little bit of Resident Evil 7 only on stream and did not care for it.
Huh. Well, if you're not into like first person horror games, that's fair enough. But
I guess it all depends on the game. But I just don't remember. Which might be a worse statement on the game, is I just don't remember playing it, but I think I did.
Well,
oh yes, they're telling me I did play it and I hated every second of it. Perfect, thank you.
Well, you know, that's fair enough.
Yeah.
There is always room for subjectivity.
And it's very hard to play a game on stream and get into it.
Yeah, I find that. If you're playing a game for the first time, you can't really focus on it.
Right.
Damn it, damn it, damn it, damn it, damn it.
And that's the box quote for Dark Souls. Damn it, damn it, damn it, damn,
damn
it.
Damn it, damn it, damn it, damn it, damn it. It's combat designed for one-on-one dueling. Mm-hmm. Don't pull more than one guy at a time, you idiot.
Focusing on just that one thing. You can do it.
Bottlenecks.
Hey, Nick's in the chat. What's the game we're playing tomorrow for Today We Try? For tomorrow, Nick and I, heads up, by the way, everyone, if you want to see me go Morel mushroom hunting, Nick and I will be playing Morel mushroom hunting.
Everything I know about Morel mushroom hunting, I know from that one Red Letter Media episode where they showed the video from that weird dude.
Yep.
Who was really into Morel mushroom hunting.
And every single person who follows me on Twitter made sure to tell me that someone made a game called Morels the Hunt about hunting Morel mushrooms as soon as it was released. I bought it on Steam and we're going to play it tomorrow on stream. So.
Well.
So it's going to be great.
Exciting original gameplay experience, is it? Hunting Morel mushrooms?
What I'm hoping for is that I know you and I have talked in the past about our love for like a Viscera cleanup project.
Oh yes.
I also legitimately liked that weird metal detecting game called like Awesome Realistic Metal Detecting.
Didn't play that one.
It's you have a metal detector and you have to find pieces of metal.
I guess it's pretty self-explanatory.
And you know what? I really enjoyed it because it's very mundane. It's very relaxing. And you're just going Morel mushroom picking, I guess. I don't know. I've played a little bit of it to make sure that it works, but I haven't played a ton of it. And we're going to play it tomorrow on stream. So.
There was a donation on YouTube that's gone off screen for me.
Oh, I see it. Astro Wolf Gaming, thank you for the £5, who says, "Hey Yahtzee and Harlack. Off topic, but I'm a prop maker. If you guys wanted a prop from a game made, what would it be and why?"
I don't know. I never really felt I needed a prop from a game in my life.
A prop from a game. I think that's a very good question. I have an unreasonable thing that I would like, which is a trick weapon from Bloodborne, because I just want to know how it would feel. Like the saw.
Yeah.
Weapon in Bloodborne. I always loved that animation and the feeling that you get when you make it longer and then suck it back in. Very satisfying feeling, and I would like to know how that feels in real life. But an unreasonable request.
Okay. Round two with the Taurus Demon. Actually, I just picked up my old bloodstain. I can't go back, can I? Because I went through the fog door. Never mind. Let's kill the dude. Run back to the tower. Let's cheese his face off.
Mm-hmm. And are you going to try again Estusless, or are
no, I think I'm done with the Estusless run now. Where's he gone? Oh, he's still there. Huh. You guys never learn not to look up at that point. Let's lure him back over and then run back to the ladder.
Oh, we're going for the double cheese.
Yeah.
That's a bold strategy.
We're a cheesy bitch.
You know, it's early game. Do what you can. We're not going to judge you. You know, we've all done it. We've all cheesed. All
right. Second ladder cheese. Cheese on toast. Just call me Welsh Rarebit.
What about this? Can you do a cheese-only Taurus demon?
Oh, that's a challenge. Come on. 100% cheese. Like that, a very badly made quarter pounder.
Oh, God. Like a very badly made quarter pounder. You did it.
Hey, triple cheese.
Do it. Triple cheese.
He never learns. Ha, call yourself a boss. Don't even turn red when your health's low.
And through the legs, can we go for the quadruple cheese?
Ah, Jesus. Okay. Through
I'm
the
sorry,
legs
did you
didn't
say,
work
ah,
that far.
Jesus.
Yeah. Cheeses of Nazareth. Okay. Go. Ah, you bastard.
The stream's on a little bit of delay, so he's knocking you off. He doesn't want that cheese.
Oh, he wants all the cheese. Right in his face. Taurus Demon's a bit Shadow of the Colossus-y in his design.
Sure, I guess.
If you ask me.
I think there is many a thing that could be called Shadow of the Colossus. Like, are you speaking just specifically of, you know, tiny eyes, lots of hair?
Yeah, his furriness is like weird stone mask thing.
Mm-hmm.
There we go. 100% cheese run.
Oh, that's a beautiful sight.
Speaking of cheese, since we've got the master key, let's see if we can cheese Havel to death. Right.
Ooh.
After I get to a bonfire.
Right.
He's quite cheesable too.
Is he?
Yeah. Quite prone to backstabs, that lad.
Oh, sure. Fisticles, thank you for the $5, who says, drunk souls, do it. You won't. Go.
I'm afraid I do not have any booze on me.
It's also like in the afternoon, man. We got stuff to do today still. our good friend Solier of Astora.
Yeah. If in case you missed the questioning, basically just always say yes when they ask. I think there's one case in the game where you should say no.
Oh.
It's when you talk to the pyromancer right after he gets back to Firelink. He says, "You don't find my magic offensive, do you?" And that's the one time in the game you say no.
I was recently capturing some gameplay footage of Sekiro, as I think I might do an episode about it at one point. But I play the modded version. I play it with the easy mod.
Oh.
Because that's... Did you forget about the dragon?
No, I didn't forget. I just wasn't 100% sure I'd heard him. And it turned out I had.
Oh.
Well, bollocks.
And I wanted to make sure that people knew that I was playing with the easy mod on Sekiro, so I also modded the look of Sekiro to be Solier.
Okay.
Playing Sekiro as Solier is really enjoyable, by the way. It's very fun.
I'm not really a modding guy. Though I like that one Dark Souls mod that changes the "you died" message to "thanks Obama."
Solier. That's what I'm saying, isn't it?
Solaire? I would say Solaire.
How is it pronounced?
I would say Solaire.
Oh, I have been pronouncing it Solier.
Why?
Because I'm very, very dyslexic, and that's honestly how I read it. which happens sometimes. Mauricio says, Jack, why were the graphics in your Red Dead video so low? That's a very good question, because I didn't even realize it until Nick, our editor-in-chief here at Escape, has pointed it out to me. I always set my graphics probably lower than they should to make sure that I get very good frame rates.
Yeah, I'm the same. When I'm running on PC, because my PC's getting on a bit. I usually usually duck it down to like 1366 by 768 resolution.
Mm-hmm.
And I always turn off motion blur because I hate it.
Oh, yeah. Well, you just have to do that in general, I feel. But so, yes, and it's something I'm keeping in mind now that I know I'm using that gameplay footage for the videos, but that's always been my default. Frame rate over visual fidelity, always.
Well, you should have known better.
I know better now.
Before you step in on YouTube turf.
How dare I? Also, Solier. How is it spelled? Hold on.
It's S-O-L-A-I-R-E. So it's solar, but with an I after the A and an E on the end.
Solier. I don't think I'm terribly off on Solier. Or no, this is. Okay, yeah. Then this is. Never mind. I'm terribly off on my Solier. And this is a true thing about me. I am very dyslexic. It's been an issue my entire life, and I was just swapping the INDA.
So that's why you hate reading in all my indie games.
It's that's a big part of it. I'm a very because of my dyslexia, I'm a very slow reader.
Right.
And so reading anything in a video game takes twice, if not three times as long than other people. So yes, that's why I really dislike reading.
And joining us now in the office is Pepper.
Pepper,
come here.
Pepper the puppy.
Yes, the stair after the door where your mummy just left. Like, he hasn't got a single moment in his day for me. Look at that.
Oh.
Just wants to know why his mummy has abandoned him.
Oh. Oh, look at that. Look at him.
He needs to be up. He needs to be up here because we got delivery men coming today. And you know he's well, we had a plumber in last night, and as my wife said, he was quite beastly to him. And I pointed out that could be because he's an animal.
Yes. And no chat. I prefer Yahtzee's audiobooks because he has a very good speaking voice.
I do.
But I read both Moogworld and
Mogworld.
And
Jam. Huh? Mogworld.
Fucking hell.
Yeah, you got Jam right. You got that fork going for you.
I feel like I can get Jam correct.
Pepper, come here. Pepper, come up.
I read both of those and enjoyed both of those, but then you started making audiobooks, and why wouldn't you choose your audiobook? Because then you get to listen to you.
Well, I'd be biased, obviously, but I quite agree. Pepper, stop staring at me. Come on, come here. Sit in my lap. Give me a good boy.
I enjoy both regular books and audiobooks. I'm currently listening to an audiobook, and I just got done reading Cloud Atlas.
That's which is a fine by. Who's that by?
That's a great question. Hold on, I'll go grab it.
Is it by David Mitchell? I know there's an author called David Mitchell who I get who that confuses me because there's a British TV personality called that as well.
By David Mitchell.
Yeah, that's what I thought. Because there's like a TV comedian in the UK who has exactly the same name, and it makes things very confusing. Okay. Fucking Fire Drake, whatever your name is.
Oh, wait, weren't you going to go Cheese Havel?
Oh, yeah. Well, I wanted to unlock the shortcut to the bonfire first.
Oh, sure, sure. There you go. Yeah, and I've read... I guess I should have read this one first, but I read his other two books in the Cloud Atlas universe first. The Bone Clocks and the Something House. I forget what it's called. Someone in the chat will tell me. And I rather enjoy his writing. He's a very, very good storyteller.
All right.
But so no, I someone was asking just because of my dyslexia if I prefer audiobooks, but I like both. It just takes me a long time to read books.
Mm. Part of the reason I haven't started my new book yet is because I haven't been reading any lately. I haven't been really in a booky mood.
Oh, interesting.
I've been trying to get through Jonathan Strange and Mr. Norrell for the longest time.
I'm sorry, you cut out a little bit. Jonathan Strange's...
Jonathan Strange and Mr. Norrell.
Jonathan Strange and Mr. Norrell. What's that?
Yes, it's a book quite relevant for me, actually. It's about magic in a sort of Victorian England setting. Like Victorian Ooh. England, but with magic on it as well.
Ooh, that's fun.
So I thought it might help be inspiring for the next book in the Differently Morphous continuity.
Oh, I'm very excited for that. I rather enjoyed your Differently Morphous.
I'm glad. The new one seems to have gone down all right. The will destroy the galaxy for cash.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
It's got like a 4.8 out of 5 rating on Audible.
Ooh.
After like 1,300 reviews, which I bet they tell me is very, very good. He said modestly.
It's hard to know the metric for something like that, right?
Oh god, it's going to happen again. Oh no, I got away from the fire that time. Oh damn it, I forgot to spend my souls.
Uh-oh.
All right, don't kill me again.
Yeah, I also agree, Sean Darwin. 12 games in 12 months could maybe cut into your writing time a bit.
Yeah, I've been... Because I've been spending so much time working on those games, that's why I haven't been able to get in the bookie mood. But we're nearly done with the project. Once it's done, then whatever the hell I thought would be proved by me completing the project will be proved.
If anything, you proved that you could make 12 games in 12 months.
I guess my point was to like show people that you shouldn't get too attached to any one idea. You know, knock them out. Put them out. If it works, fine. If it doesn't, move on to the next.
Yeah. I think that, and I know we talked about this a bit on one of our streams, but you know, just the importance of starting something.
Yeah.
Cannot be understated. Just if you want to do something, just start it. There's so many opportunities.
Something like prevaricate. Don't write up detailed world-building notes, just get started.
Absolutely.
Because the considerably harder part is finishing it. But the part that's hardest than both starting and finishing it is getting through that bloody middle part.
Absolutely. Always.
All right, heading towards Havel's place.
Okay, head towards there. I'm gonna go refill my coffee and change my camera settings because it's getting dark. I will be back in a moment.
Fair enough. Use that same logic with your new baby. Don't get too attached to it. Thank you, Mauricio596. Good advice. Do I prefer Undertale or Dark Souls, Grady 711? Well, the reason why I was so non-committal in the video this week is because I'm not sure I could rate one higher than the other. They offer different things. Undertale, obviously, is one of my favourite and most important artistic storytelling experiences, but Dark Souls is just my comfort zone. I can come back and play it at any time. I'd replay Dark Souls past the time. I'd replay Undertale as a sort of special occasion. Alright, have all the Rock Johnson. Where are you? Woohoo! Woohoo! Oh, blimey, you've got a lot of health, haven't you? We might be here a while, everyone. Hello again.
Hello, how's Havel?
I'm in the process of cheesing him.
I'm watching.
This may take a while still.
You're very weak. But doing a fantastic job.
Oh, bugger. So I got distracted by Bubblegum Hand in the chat saying the shield isn't going to help you, you know. And I thought, you know what, you're right. Perhaps I should unequip it and two-hand this. But then I lost concentration.
First of all, how dare you lose concentration? I stood up to close my door, and my earbuds shocked me.
Huh.
The static electricity in my earbuds literally shocked me. Huh. That's a new one.
Thanks for the 20 NOKs, Blackout. I'm not sure what that is. Who says, Yahtzee on best of the worst when? Probably never.
I think you've mentioned before that you're not necessarily a movie guy.
Yeah, I'd feel out of place. I mean, if they do a best of the worst about video game movies, then sure. Perhaps I could have something to contribute.
Right.
But I'm very much video game focused. I don't watch films that often.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we've talked every once in a while. I think I've mentioned this before, that we have in the studio like a nice list of possible show ideas. including on that list is, you know, a video game themed episode. You know, where we watch the Mario Brothers movie, maybe some other ones, and we have never once used that list. It's got like 12 good episodes on it, of like, oh yeah, here's three movies we can do, here's three movies we can do, and every time we do an episode of Best of the Worst, it's like, we'll just find three random ones.
It's just nice to have a list like that. I've got a list of potential ideas for Dev Diary, but every week I just come up with something. I think, well, I don't want to use up the list. Might as well use this one I've just come up with.
Much like me and grenades in Dark Souls.
The list is for emergencies.
Hey, Zalthia guy, thanks for subscribing.
Hey, now I'm two-handing it. Each backstab does a whole 5 more damage.
Oh, well then. Now you've got it. And Muscus, thank you for the 22 knock. Who says, keep up the marvelous word. Also, please say Schmorboard.
That's not North Korean dollars, is it?
I have no idea.
I don't think anyone was allowed to use the internet in North Korea.
Maybe it's actually just Kim Jong-il masquerading as Moskus.
Well, that would be weird because he's dead. I suppose that's why he's masquerading, yeah.
That's why he's masquerading. Oh, am I thinking of Kim Jong-un?
Yeah, Kim Jong-un's the new one.
Oh, he's the new one. There you go. And Ignoramus Online, thank you for the two euros. So he says, any advice for writing comedy and expanding vocabulary?
Well, the workaday model for writing jokes is say something that makes the audience come to an assumption, and then say something else that proves their assumption incorrect.
Aha!
That's the basic model.
You're talking about juxtaposition, which is the basis of most comedy.
Oh, I died. You know, I think cheesing Havel, as possible as it is, probably not that interesting to watch. Let's just move on.
That's fair. And as far as expanding your vocabulary, the best way to do that is reading books and listening to things you normally wouldn't listen to.
Yeah. Podcasts. Mm-hmm. Interesting educational podcasts about things. I listen to The Dollop, which is an American history podcast.
Ooh,
which
okay.
I find fun to listen to.
Sure.
Although it's been increasingly depressing. Because they've been big on the lessons from history that we really need to relearn for the modern age. Lately.
That's funny. I wonder why they would be commenting on that right at this exact moment. So video games are fun!
Hey,
and we like playing them!
Escapism! That's why I like VR. VR allows me to literally blind and deafen myself to the world.
Yeah.
And be in a magic world where I can be a spaceman.
Or a knight fighting evil enemies. Very simple. Fight the thing, they're the bad guy. Everything's very simple.
You're talking about things feeling satisfying in games.
Yes.
Earlier. And that's when you said that, I thought of the game I've just been playing on VR, which is a game called Boneworks.
Oh, yes.
Which has very satisfying, realistic gun mechanics, and I can't really explain why it feels so good to do. But when you pick up a gun, and then with your real actual hands, reload it with a magazine, and then pull the slide back, and then put it away in your shoulder holster so you can pull it out later to kick ass, it makes you feel like a badass. Then get two pistols, put them in both shoulder holsters, pull them both out while running for cover, and feel like Max Payne or something.
The certifiable gun nut amongst my group of friends, guns can be very satisfying. There's a reason that they're so popular here in America.
Because they make your dick feel big.
Solid. Feels dense, you know?
Thanks for the $1.99, Ignoramus Online, who says, another quick question. Advice for writing horror? Well, there's so many ways you can explore that theme.
I think no matter what, the advice for writing anything is to start writing it.
Yeah. And well, read a lot of it first, and then start writing it.
You have to start writing it in order to get feedback on the things that you're writing, and listening to feedback is very important, especially when you're starting out. Also, because you asked earlier about writing comedy and writing horror, might I suggest choosing a lane?
Well, they often go together, comedy and horror.
I think they can.
Surprise works equally well in both.
Sure. Both are the same concept of the build and release of tension.
Yeah.
But I think it's difficult to do both very well. So, you know, maybe choose one to do first, and then the other, and then try mixing the two of them together.
You know what I think makes for good horror?
What's that?
Is the situation where you realize after the fact you were in danger all along, and didn't realize it. And moment when you realize that. Like, you ever seen Dark Water? It's like a Japanese horror film.
I have not.
There's a bit where it's about this like single mother in a haunted apartment trying to like protect her daughter. Uh-huh. And there's a bit where she's hugging her daughter, and then something horrible is knocking at the door. And then the door opens and it's her daughter. And then you're like, what the fuck am I hugging then? That's what I mean.
Sure.
The sort of realization that the situation wasn't as secure as you thought.
Sure, the floor dropping beneath you kind of thing.
Yeah.
Sure, yeah, I like that. There's so many good examples of that. Like, have you seen Get Out?
No, I have not. I've heard it's good.
It's fantastic horror movie. It's very, you know, it's more atmosphere and psychological as far as actual, like, you know, blood and guts and stuff. But yes, there's a very similar moment that I'll say without spoiling, that where you kind of realize the fuller picture of everything, and it's quite beautiful when you get that stomach drop.
Okay, no esters and a tiny sliver of health left. Now I will kill this pig.
good luck.
Get out the old alluring skull. Pop it in the fire.
I've seen the Jennifer. The what? What are you guys talking about? Hold on. The chat's moving too fast. We're talking about horror. Hey, Crocodile Brain. Thanks for subscribing for 4 months now. We very much appreciate it. Crocodile Brain says, my sub info keeps getting messed up. Rawr. Keep up the good work anyways. Well then, thanks for subscribing for however many months you have subscribed.
A lot of players don't realize you get the alluring skull at this point because this is supposed to be the alluring skull tutorial.
Oh.
Just toss him in the fire and watch the piggy die.
Oh.
Yeah, dead pig.
You know what? I've always fought the pig.
Yeah, you're doing it wrong.
Apparently... Apparently, I am just a sucker.
All right. Well, the piggy dies permanently, so I might go back and to that bonfire.
Mm-hmm. Oh, that's a good question from Grady711, who, you know, Yahtzee, considering that Undertale was on your list of the decade, did you play Deltarune at all?
I started playing like the free download thing that came out, but I didn't stick with it. I got a lot of time. I don't have a lot of spare time, and I don't know, something about the fact that it was just Undertale with all the bits moved around made it feel a bit less attractive. Like, sure. It was just another dip in the pot.
Much like we were talking about earlier, with kind of a good thing that you know is less good than a good thing that you're surprised by.
Yeah, kind of. And I seek out new experiences because I remember all the... Like, you'll play a lot of shit, but the one or two times you do find something that blows your mind is one that you'll remember for the rest of your life.
Absolutely. It's like that one Beck album. I don't know if you're a fan of Beck as a musician.
I have liked his songs.
I enjoy just about every single Beck album ever made. I think he's a fantastic musician. But then he put out that one record a couple years ago that was... They were brand new songs, but every song was in the style of an album that he's done. Kind of like almost like a cover of his discography.
I find it hard to like anything by Scientologists. Because, you know, the fact that they're Scientologists just hangs over it all.
Didn't he come out recently and say he is not a Scientologist? I want to say.
I heard he was.
I heard he was too. I think he came out to say, nope, it's okay to like me.
Oh, but, good.
Which is good.
Good for him for risking being unpersoned, I suppose. Ooh, or whatever the term is.
Oh, man. No adjectives. Just gifted a bunch of subscriptions.
Thanks.
Thank you,
no adjectives. I can think of one adjective. Generous.
Ooh, you did it!
You'll have to change your name.
How dashingly clever of you. You're certainly a cunning linguist.
Certainly am. What was that really clever thing I said before the stream? I've forgotten it already.
Oh, by the way, you did. It was very, very clever. I remember that.
Yeah, I remember that we both thought it was clever, and now I've forgotten what it was. This is why you should write these things down.
Always write it down. Always, always. Yahtzee's moving up in the world, collaborating with celebrity guests like Jack Packard. It's very true.
Which of us is the celebrity guest?
I think it's... Well, it's your show, so technically it's me.
Yeah, you're the guest.
But if you're asking who is the bigger celebrity, it's clearly you.
Well, if we go by Twitter followers, maybe.
I think in general, more people might know you.
Fair enough. I don't want to sound immodest, but I've been doing this a while now.
Right. It's very possible that more people might know Red Letter Media, but not specifically me.
Well, if you've watched much Red Letter Media videos, Jack is the bald one.
Exactly.
Who shows up now and then.
Who isn't one
of the main three.
Exactly. Yes, and I'm just here bugging Yahtzee while he tries to play. Exactly. That's my job today. Distract Yahtzee. Alta Hawk. That's my new job is just playing Yahtzee's games. Exactly.
Oh, yeah. You might have a new one soon.
Oh, jeez.
Hoping to get that done today, actually. Although, you know, might be a better idea to, since you mentioned you're dyslexic, it might be better to get someone else to do this one,
is it a very reading intensive game?
Well, this one's, it's called Hold the Phone. It's about following instructions on really annoying phone calls, and there's a lot of like deliberately difficult instruction following. Like, to do such and such, press 1. To do such and such, press the square root of the previous option's number.
Oh, jeez.
And you have to do it in time or the phone call gets cancelled and you have to start all over again. Oh, and the idea is to get the phone call done before your blood pressure meter fills and you die.
I will certainly fail, but, you know, if you need a tester... You don't have to make games specifically for me. You don't have to is because Edmund McMillan will make them for me specifically.
Well, it's good to be given a parameter, especially for me doing a project like Dev Diary. And I have to keep coming up with new ideas for. Mm-hmm. Like when I noticed someone doing speedruns of the first game, I decided to deliberately make a game based around doing it as a speedrun.
Oh, sure. Was that the cleaner?
Yeah, that was the cleaner. I just think it might be interesting to it might be interesting, you know, do a game based design specifically for a dyslexic person. There's a challenge.
Ooh. Well, there you go. You're welcome. I'm just a fountain of ideas.
I think I'm at the game that's peak concentrate or get mobbed by low level enemies. That is the theme of this whole area. Like now, for example. I forgot about this dude.
I'm watching that right now.
I can't forget
about that dude. How dare you forget about him?
Well, back on topic.
Oh, yes.
what else would you say were the most significant games of the decade? Because the one that a lot of commenters pointed out that I didn't mention at all was Minecraft.
Yeah. I think Minecraft might be not necessarily the most important game, but one of the most important properties to the next generation.
Oh yeah, I mean that almost transcended gaming, really.
Yeah.
Minecraft.
Mm-hmm. Where, you know, not only did it, you know, help the indie game revolution as it was developed by, so you know, one person, but it also solidified crafting as a core gameplay mechanic.
Yeah, for better or worse, everyone jumped on that, didn't they?
Oh, they jumped on it so freaking hard. It also was at the forefront of procedural generation.
Maybe it didn't occur to me because well, all game reviewers are specialists to a certain extent. Nobody likes every kind of game.
Mm-hmm.
And I consider myself a specialist in narrative game design. And ooh, Minecraft, okay, of course, is specifically designed to be a zero-narrative sandbox experience. Not that I didn't play quite a lot of it.
Mm-hmm.
But I found it was one of my favorite time-killing games for a while. I just kill a few hours putting together a big castle in Minecraft.
Oh, sure, sure. I don't know if I it's so tough because I also did not think I'll tell you this, for me personally, another part of why Minecraft slips off is I assumed it had been around a lot longer than 10 years.
Well, it depends on what you go by, because I think it in its like early beta, early access stages, it was like before 2010.
That's
but
what
it only really, but it only really took off like a couple of years later.
Right.
Someone donated, I think it was Fisticles again on YouTube.
Oh yes, I see that. Fisticles has a very serious question, not on the topic of Minecraft, which is, why is Dark Souls one of the favorite games of the furry community?
Well, I might follow that up with a question of my own, Fisticles. Is it?
I think Dark Souls is a favorite game of many communities because it's a very good game.
Yeah, I would say correlation does not imply causation there.
Ooh, there you go. Do you know that there's a correlation between ice cream sales and shark attacks?
I did not know that.
Mostly because it's summertime when people are at the beaches. Correlation does not imply causation.
Exactly.
Is the moral of that story. But in any case, Minecraft is terribly, terribly important. Minecraft will be to the next generation what Star Wars is to our generation.
Oh yeah, because all the kids who spend their entire childhoods playing it will one day be in charge of the world.
Exactly.
It's a rule that popular culture is always nostalgic for about 20 years before the present. Because that's the point when all the people who were in control of the media were about 12 years old. Which is like the ideal age. When you're just old enough to start really appreciating works, but not too old to be completely jaded.
Right, before cynicism really digs in.
Yeah.
And you're just enjoying things to enjoy things.
And this principle has served me well, because I predicted, in accordance with this principle, that the next big nostalgia wave would be for, like, retro early 3D games. Like Quake, and your Duke Nukem 3D, and your PS1 games, like your Crash Bandicoot. And that's been driving quite a big nostalgia wave lately. There's a lot of early 3D-style shooters on Steam. Yeah.
Retro Doom likes.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
So the question is, what's the next nostalgia wave, bearing all this in mind?
You and I can't judge that because we were already cynical in the early aughts. But whatever property was very popular in the early aughts.
I want to say the next stage will be the PlayStation 2. Which is still probably one of the best consoles that there's ever been, really.
As far as output, I would agree with you. So many games.
Yeah, and you know why? Because they had strong third-party support.
Yes.
Which did result in a lot of, you know, hacked-out garbage, but it also resulted in some damn fine games.
Mm-hmm.
Like Silent Hill 2, The Prince of Persia, Sands of Time trilogy, Shadow of the Colossus, and many other of my all-time favorites.
Absolutely. Next stage, Fred Durst. Fred Durst just made a movie. I'm trying to think of what was big and popular in the 90s. Or counter argument, Yahtzee, was the 90s the start of nostalgia for the sake of nostalgia, and there will be nothing new? Because in the 90s, early 2000s, wasn't that when we were starting to get nostalgia for swing music?
Couldn't say, but I know sometimes the 20-year nostalgia rule, like, does like a little double jump.
Oh.
And if media is produced that's nostalgic for like 40 years ago, because 20 years ago was nostalgic for 20 years before that.
Oh, Jesus.
I mean, for an example of that, look at Mad Men, which was about the 60s,
mm-hmm.
but almost has a 1980s feel to it.
Oh.
So it was made in the 2000s to be nostalgic for the 80s, the 80s being nostalgic for the 60s.
Oh, Jesus. Oh, Jesus. Everything's broken.
One of the classic examples, of course, was Happy Days, which was made in the 70s, but was set in the 50s.
Which itself was just a... Happy Days didn't start that. It was American Graffiti. Which was, you know, a very similar thing. So basically, George Lucas ruined everything.
George Lucas has had nostalgia in the palm of his fat hand for as long as any of us have been alive.
And if you think about it, in the early aughts, late 90s...
Oh, bugger. Sorry.
That's when the Star Wars prequels came out, which was, you know, nostalgia for the nostalgia.
Yeah, people have been looking at the prequels with fresh eyes lately.
Have they?
Yeah, they're all wrong. It's still shit.
I mean, they're terrible movies.
A lot of people like taking a second look after the sequel trilogy turned out so bland. I have long had a theory that the reason why Star Wars is still such a big thing is because the prequels were so bad. It sort of kicked in everyone's defensiveness.
Sure. I can say for sure, I know this is something that was very easy for me to call, but I definitely called it now that the new Star Wars is out. I'm seeing a lot of positivity for Rian Johnson's The Last Jedi, which...
Yeah.
I enjoy it.
Because everyone was down on it because it was trying something different, right?
Right.
It was trying to undo the the basic tropes that had already been established.
Exactly. It was trying to move forward, and everyone hated that.
Yeah. And everything it undid got undid straight back.
So I am enjoying seeing everyone go, well, you know what? Maybe The Last Jedi wasn't so bad.
This is the thing, you know? People just don't know what they want. No one ever predicts what the next big thing is, because if you ask people what they want, they'll just say, this thing I already like, I want more of that.
Mm-hmm.
And then you give them that, and they're like, it's a bit derivative, isn't it?
Right.
So people don't know. Don't ask people what they want.
Never, ever, ever. Handsome Aaron says, hey, Jack, you were in the first Star Wars review, the Mr. Plinkett
you
Star
were.
Wars review.
You had more hair. I remember that
I
very well.
I had hair and a beard. How much input involvement did you have in those reviews? The amount that you see me talking.
Yeah. You were just like a vox pop, really, weren't you?
Yeah, I was just a talking head, and, you know, the... Mike actually, that day, Mike was helping me shoot a music video that I was shooting. And in the middle of the shoot, he goes, hey, can we pause for a little bit? And he filmed me, and he filmed Jillian for her part. And he's like, I just need to borrow you for a little bit. And he asked me these stupid Star Wars questions.
I know this is asking a bit secondhand, but what was it like for Mike when that really blew up? Because I might have some experience with going viral. And I remember when The Phantom Menace review came out, and I was like, this is... well, I watch Red Letter Media to this day, because it was amazing.
Well, and you know, we were in the middle of shooting Feeding Frenzy.
Right.
Which is a movie that also has a very Mr. That has Mr. Plinkett. Mm. Rich is Mr. Plinkett.
Yeah, it's got the rich Mr. Plinkett in it.
And, you know, Mike had already done a few Mr. Plinkett reviews of
Star Trek. Yeah, I went back and watched all of them.
Oh, yeah, no, I mean, I remember back in those days, you know, Mike showed those to me, and I was like, Mike, these are brilliant. He found a great character.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah.
And he found an interesting way, and not to circle jerk us too much, but, you know, very similarly with you and Zero Punctuation, is you found a unique way to do criticism.
Yeah, I think we found a very similar approach, the two of us, because I think a lot of it is like occupying a character while you do criticism. Because when you do that, you can sort of distance yourself from it a bit, and people, in my experience, are more willing to come with you on what will normally mark you out as a massive antisocial nerd. if you deliberately adopt a character that sort of plays up the antisocial aspect, people will come with you on it a lot better, I find.
Absolutely. Well, and you know, really the idea is, it's tale as old as time, which is infotainment, is you want to keep the audience engaged while you're feeding information to them. And having an interesting character, having an interesting visual style, much like Zero Punctuation was, really just helps along that journey. And so I remember back in the Next Generation Plinkett reviews, you know, just being very happy and looking forward to seeing where it was going to go. And when it started going viral, I think, you know, like Simon Pegg was one of the first that that like reached out and was like, hey, this is brilliant, you know, thanks for making these. And we're like, oh, he's a real person, you know, he's an actual person who watches these. And yeah, I mean, it was great.
It was almost exactly the same thing with me. When I realized it had taken off was when I got contacted by a famous person. In my case, it was Peter Molyneux.
Oh, okay.
Who was the famous eccentric designer of the Fable games and the Black and White, and populous back in the day, but famous gaming weirdo, Peter Molyneux. Which he said he appreciated the video.
Oh, no, and, you know, it was very fun, and, you know, it was also... You know, I know for Mike specifically, it was like, what can I do with this? And I know when originally when they were shooting Half in the Bag, and I was there for that first shoot just because they had some extras and they needed some extra camera movement. They were terrified of just like, you know, are people going to watch this? You know, people are so used to Mr. Plinkett.
Yeah.
But Mr. Plinkett isn't sustainable, you know.
Right. You can't do an hour long video every week.
Oh God. No, and have it be well researched and have it be as intricate as the Plinkett videos are. And of course now I think more people probably know them from Half in the Bag or Best of the Worst than they know Mr. Plinkett.
Yeah, they pulled that off. Mohammed DK20 asks if John Romero ever spoke to me before E3 2019. No, that was the first time he and I met. That awkward interview we had at his E3 booth.
Oh.
He seemed nice.
He does seem like a good guy.
Yeah, he makes mistakes. He's made mistakes, but who hasn't?
Right. Before I forget, Fisticles, I did see your $5. Thank you. And Fisticles wants to know, why is RLM such a popular site to the furry community?
Oh, I think he's just having a funny, that Fisticles.
Well, so here a fun little note, and Mike, I want to say Mike and Rich talk about this on one of the behind the scenes DVDs. They have like a little history of Mr. Plinkett. I forget what DVD it's on. It's a DVD they put out. One of the first sites to distribute the Star Trek Next Generation Plinkett reviews was a furry message board.
Again, that's a correlation and causation thing, isn't it?
Exactly. Much like Dark Souls, it's, you know, any community can find anything good.
Well, speaking of correlation and causation, didn't they find there's a disproportionately high number of pedophiles among Star Trek fans?
What?
That's what I've heard.
Where are you getting this information from?
I just heard it somewhere. I couldn't tell you my source at this point.
Well,
I'm sure someone in the chat will have heard this as well.
Oh, jeez.
But it's worrying because I consider myself a Star Trek fan.
Exactly, and you know you don't want to be in with that lot.
No. Ooh, Titanite shard, just what I need because we're near the blacksmith now.
Nice. I can't read your name properly. Potase Solarum says, Yahtzee, just so you know, Will Save the Galaxy for Food has forever ruined the word bracket for me. I hear someone say it, and in the back of my mind, I always feel like they said it to be a rude word.
Yeah, I've been like swearing with pilot math in my head for quite a while now. I can't even remember where I got the idea for that. I just liked the idea of having a unique lexicon of swears. The premise being in that one, of course, is that the pilots in the Galaxy for Food series, they don't really understand the technology behind quantum tunneling, but they know it involves mathematics. So they started using mathematical terms as swear words.
That's infinitely more fun than just actual swearing.
I know. I mean, you've reminded me of the Thief reboot. Because, of course, the original Thief games used TAF as a made-up swear word.
Mm-hmm.
And then in the Thief reboot, everyone just said fuck all the time. And I was like, this isn't fun anymore. TAF was fun.
Yes.
But fuck is not fun.
You know, in Firefly, you have Goram.
Hmm.
In the Battlestar Galactica remake, you had fracking. It's always good fun to have fake swears.
You don't want to go overboard with your fake swears, though. There was, what was it called? Defiance? That TV series that was an MMO for a while as well. That was like a sci-fi thing. And they had a made-up swear word, which was Starko.
Starko?
Starko, spelled S-H-T-A-K-O. And that doesn't feel like something you'd blurt out at the spur of the moment. It sounds a little bit overdone every time you say it.
You know what? Every swear needs a one-syllable version of it.
Yeah.
And so then your one syllable is what? Shta?
Or ko?
Yeah, neither of those are good.
No. I guess we should be using this long sword instead of this short sword.
These are the tough decisions that you have to make.
Or a battle axe, maybe.
Ooh.
How do they... Just checking how they scale. So a battle axe is more strength. The swords are like dex and strength across the board.
Mm-hmm.
And the club, of course, is pure strength.
And what are you min-maxing at the moment?
I don't know. I don't care.
Are you just going... Yeah, you're just kind of going even keel because...
Yeah.
You're probably not going
to
play
this. Because you never know what you're going to... want to use further down the line.
That's, you know, that's both in my couple of Skyrim playthroughs and in my Dark Souls playthrough. Your first playthrough is always kind of middle of the road, and it's never as satisfying as picking a direction. You know, like once you say I'm going strength, hell or high water, and you just start min-maxing, it's always more fun.
Thanks for the 199, OK Cool Shades, who would like to remind us that I need to stop breathing so heavily into the mic. Sorry, it's right under my nose.
That's the downside of your headset microphone.
Yeah, I've got professional mics, but a bit more of an ass to set up.
Absolutely.
And I got this headset right here.
So why not? I have this guy now mounted to my desk, which I really enjoy. You know, I got him on, nice. I got this on an arm so I can fold it away when I'm not using it. It's very, very handy.
Yeah, I can't really mount stuff to the desk because I got to go between my laptop on the desk and my gaming computer on the couch where I stream.
Oh.
So I just have a couple of mic stands.
Sure, sure.
And I just stick a microphone in as required.
Hey, Darkwing Schmuck, thank you for subscribing. And Alta Hawk, thank you for subscribing.
I'm hearing bells ringing a lot.
Are you by the bells?
No, it's just every time another player somewhere in the world successfully rings the bell after defeating the gargoyles, you hear a bell in your world.
And I would never know that because I always play offline. I just don't want to fuck around.
Yeah, there you go. One of the many little touches you'd miss.
Yeah, well, I feel overall, something I legitimately hate in this and in Bloodborne was all the little messages that people would leave.
But that's part of the fun.
Ah, fuck that.
I always thought
hated it.
From Software games are almost communal experiences because you'll almost never find everything you need to find out just from playing it by yourself blind.
Mm-hmm.
Usually, I mean, when I first played Dark Souls, it was lost on me, but it was after I'd read up a bit on it and watched someone else's Let's Play of it that I gave it a second look and realized just how deep and fun it can be when you get a little bit of a hint now and then.
Sure.
And I assume that's what the messages on the floor are for.
And I see that, but I would much rather just, you know, head over to the wiki and do a little reading. I don't want things distracting me.
I mean, look at this.
Taking in the atmosphere.
Look at this. Bonfire ahead. I might not have known that.
Touché.
All right.
The next best of the worst. I know they have a couple. They still have a couple more from special guests in the can.
Some more Macaulay Culkin.
Yes, that they are working on editing. I think a couple more. I don't know exactly how many they have, so I cannot tell you when the next is, as I don't edit them. So I'm very sorry. Let's see here. Red Panda, thank you for the 10 pounds, who says, since you mentioned Star Wars earlier, and I knew that was a mistake, I was thinking it could make a good, horror, I assume game. Think of mining a ship where the crew are stuck on it with a Sith and they're trying to escape. What do you guys think?
Well, it's only because you could, like, apply virtually any sci-fi thing in the Star Wars universe. It's just a matter of sticking names and faces on, right?
Mm-hmm.
Because that's what Star Wars is. It's a brand. It's not really a coherent, consistent saga anymore.
You got it. You're doing it. It's just a brand full of space wizards, so literally anything can happen.
Yeah. So, yeah, you could do horror, you could do romantic comedies, you could do an office romance drama on the Death Star.
could we though not, is what I think.
Well, yes, could we not? Could we not? Could we not?
But really, could we not?
Yeah.
I think that's why The Mandalorian, for me at least, rings with much more promise than The Rise of Skywalker does, as it's the first instance where a Star Wars property goes slightly outside of its boundaries. Not very far.
Yeah. Just, you know, exploring the universe a bit, not bringing it back to the fucking Skywalkers all the time.
Yes. It was the first time that I feel like it dipped a toe. And, you know, some of the novelization did, but also some of the novelization was pure garbage.
Right.
and so it's very possible that now that The Mandalorian has been successful on Disney Plus, we might see more of that. How much more of that do you want to see is the real question.
Would it be fair to say, do you think, that maybe Star Wars needs The Mandalorian at this point more than The Mandalorian needs to be Star Wars.
Ooh.
Is Star Wars as it was kind of done, and The Mandalorian would have been fine if it had just been generic sci-fi adventure series?
To answer your question, yes and no.
Ooh.
to be a complete dick about it, both, which is Star Wars is such a strong brand that even though The Rise of the Skywalker isn't performing as well as expected, it's still going to make $1 billion.
Well, yeah,
because it's Star Wars, right? And even though it's a complete clusterfuck of a movie,
but
it's still going to do very well.
It's going to do very well, but that's because of twats.
Yeah,
because all the twats go, ooh, thing we know.
Yep.
Should we really just resign ourselves to be beholden to the twats forever?
I'm going to try not to get into politics.
Now, why on earth did you think I was talking about politics?
Oh, no. No, I think the real power here is in where people spend their money, right? That's all Disney cares about. Disney does not care about making quality films. They only care about taking people's money.
Right.
And the twats, as you say, will continue to spend money on Star Wars. There are many, many people who go to see movies who don't have good taste.
Right.
In movies. and that will continue to be true. I think it's really smart, but so that's the no, Mandalorian isn't needed. But the yes in that Mandalorian is needed is that us jaded fucks can continue to enjoy Star Wars. This is Disney quite literally having their cake and eating it too.
Okay.
Is they're keeping us engaged by putting out something that's a little bit different, a little higher quality, that's good, but they're also putting out stuff that the twats will enjoy.
Well, all hail Emperor Disney then. Now and forever.
Hey, NF, a god, I don't know how to pronounce your name. Thanks for the 5 things, and he has a very good point, which is don't taint Dark Souls with new Star Wars.
Yes, I'm sorry. Well, you don't want to be playing Jedi Fallen Order then.
Hey!
Or is that Dark Souls tainted by Star Wars, or Star Wars tainted by Dark Souls? We'll never know.
Oh, geez. You just made me go cross-eyed a little bit.
We ask the heavy questions on this stream.
We only go deep. Let's see here. I see some people with highlighted messages. I don't know. Oh, that's right. That's like the new system. Mm. Some people don't even like Star Wars, but they watch it just to fit in. Hey, I try to keep up with what's popular.
This is what we call FOMO.
Yeah. Ooh, I like it. I mean, not FOMO in general, but
yeah,
that's true. You have to keep up with what the people are talking about, and for a long time it was sports, and now the nerds rule the world, so you got to keep up with what the nerds watch.
Well, I identify somewhat as an aloof old fuddy-duddy. Mm-hmm. So I feel less of the FOMO.
That's fair.
I'm not missing out on your shit. You're missing out on my shit.
I do feel a pressure. You know, I don't always succumb to that pressure, but I definitely feel a pressure in certain spheres to know what people are talking about.
Hipster, that's the word.
You're a hipster. Yeah, you tell me
you like all those live service multiplayer games. I'm like, well, I only like this one obscure live service multiplayer game called Remnant from the Ashes.
Ooh.
Which is just a completely different experience to the things you like.
Oh, of course, of course. Quantum Lemons, thank you for subscribing. And Stuart Adams, thank you for the £2, who asks you to please kick that b-hole lar tech off a cliff.
But then that would lock me out of his storyline. You got to do the storylines. Hi, Lord Shrek.
Oh, yes, and he has a very fun battle later.
Yeah.
I like his three-on-one battle.
Although he does kind of break Firelink Shrine for a while.
Yes, sure. But it's worth it for that very fun battle.
Well, speaking of, let's go into the gargoyle fight and see how we do in the last few minutes of the stream.
Yay!
Do I have any pine resin that might help? Oh, yep. Gold pine resin is a useful thing to have.
Also a thing that I have never used in Dark Souls.
Well, again, it's another thing you might feel tempted to just save for when you really need it. But if you ever watch, speed runs or skill runs, they're throwing this shit around like wallpaper.
Speaking of, have you watched any Awesome Games Done Quick?
No, I haven't. As of yet.
Oh, I was watching a few yesterday, and they were exceedingly fun. Pokemon Sapphire, I saw beat in under 2 hours. So much fun to listen to them talk about the strategies.
And which of the 9 million Pokemon games was that?
That was one of the Game Boy Advanced ones.
Oh right. Should have guessed because they were still on the gemstones at that stage.
Yeah, but the most fun part was my health needs to be. Or the health of my Pokemon needs to be above 37 and below 42 in order to get this move to trigger.
Yeah, it's crazy, that sort of thing.
Oh, yeah, that's real. That's mathematical dissection, and I enjoy that.
All right, let's chop a tail or two.
Do it! Sora383, thank you for the $6.99, I assume Canadian. Who says, Jack and Yahtzee, do you guys have any team-up projects coming up this year?
Well,
and if so, can you tell us a bit about them?
Well, it's funny you should say that. Because that's something that is very much on the agenda, although I'm not sure how much we can say at this stage.
I don't think we can say anything at this stage, but there are talkings.
Yes, there's certainly talking going on.
Lots and lots of talkings going on.
Oh, bugger, bugger, bugger. Come on, come on, come on.
Bugger, 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 bugger.
Bugger, bugger, bugger. That's my default.
Oh, I like it.
Come on.
And then while
the dude behind him was doing a fire attack. I was going for the all or nothing charge to get the last bit of health off. Oh, well. I'm willing to call that a stream.
Nothing more appropriate in a Dark Souls stream than ending on "you died."
Oh, exactly.
One more, Dan B. Thank you for the $3. Who wants to know if I ever played Demon's Souls? And I did a little bit. Rich and I streamed that back in the day, but I obviously did not get very far.
Yeah, I reviewed it, but I reviewed it before I had the Dark Souls epiphany, and I realized Dark Souls is actually good. So Demon's Souls was kind of lost on me. I was like, it's too hard.
The Dark Souls epiphany is a real thing.
Yeah.
There was one moment specifically in Dark Souls when you're under the bridge. Mm. And there's that one guy and then the other guy kind of on the ledge right before the rats. Mm. That's when I had my Dark Souls epiphany. I got to that stage and I said, oh, this is brilliant. I know specifically where.
All right.
Bismarch, thank you for the $7.
Yes, no comment though. Right, well, thanks for watching the post-EP stream. Remember to watch this week's Zero Punctuation on The Escapist, which was a retrospective view of the most significant games of the 2010s. Well, some of them. Can't do much in 5 minutes. I was Yahtzee Croshaw, of course. I was joined by Jack Packard.
Yes, and keep an eye out next Monday for new Underdeveloped, and come back here, wherever you're watching, tomorrow afternoon for me and Nick playing. We're going to play the Morel hunting game, which is going to be great.
That'll be, talk about FOMO. That'll be the the kids will be talking about for years.
On Morel mushroom hunting. It's going to be great.
There appears to be an emoticon of you dressed as a clown in the Twitch
yes,
chat.
Yes, that's true. You know, I was a professional clown at one point in my
life. I was aware.
And fun little story to end the stream on. Jokingly, one day during a previously recorded stream, someone asked how much money it would take for me to do an entire stream dressed as a clown and be entirely silent for the entire stream. I put out an amount of money that I thought was ridiculous, and they paid it anyway.
Ooh, that's one way to make money.
I did an entire stream dressed as a clown, entirely silent.
Nice. And I'm sure it's still on YouTube if you want to see that.
Abso-freaking-lutely.
In fact, I seem to remember you were playing Stardew Valley for that one.
Ooh, very possible.
Man, I feel like, you know, I might creep you out to knowing all these obscure details about videos you've done and your life.
I remember us talking in the past, and I think we both admire the things we have done before, and that's okay.
All right.
Is it weird that I've read all your books?
Well, not really, because that's what they're there for.
Exactly.
It would be weird if you like knew my exact street address when I was a kid, I suppose.
Oh well, I you know.
That's out there somewhere. One of the old games I made when I was young and naive had a little readme file in it.
Oh.
But anyway.
I have that on a plaque on my wall. I won't share that with anyone. Don't worry.
All right. All right. Remember to follow us on Twitter. You'll see our Twitter handles just under our names on the stream. Right there. There's mine. And if I don't see you at the weekend stream, at usual time, 1 p.m. Pacific, I will see you at the next PostCP stream next Wednesday. Same time, same place. I'll see you then.
Bye, everyone.
Bye. Oh, Pepper, you can always tell when we're signing off, can't you? Yes, you can get attention now. Say goodbye, everyone. Goodbye, Pepper.